To see silver trade at 18 again would not surprise me. To see it trade at under 14 again would absolutely shock me. I don't think that's in the cards at all. But there are people out there that have a bigger following than me in the mainstream that say, you know, gold's going to test the 1050 bottom. I really, really doubt that.
It really
the
seems
problem
like
with a lot of people is that they have an amateur's perspective, which means that they think if they didn't get in at the low, they've missed the move. Actually, most of your best traders and wealthiest people on the planet just take out the middle. In other words, they might not even get in the silver market again until it's past 26 and ride it from 26 to 46 and get out and take massive amounts of money out of the market as silver moves up to 100.
One new gold stock making big headlines since its start last April. Acquiring gold for $5 to $10 per ounce in the ground, which is dramatically lower than the $50 to $100 per ounce in the ground other companies have been paying.
To learn more about what hard asset investors are calling a mineral bank, visit crushthestreet.com/investright.
Hello, everyone, and thanks for tuning in today. I am Kenneth Amaduri, and I'm joined today with David Morgan to give us a timely update on the markets here with what's going on. He is the editor, the owner of the Morgan Report, and he's been on the show before. He's an expert when it comes to, you know, investing in general. He, you know, an expert in commodities, precious metals, and if you want to, you know, be able to follow someone who is a leading expert, a leading thought leader when it comes to investment research, definitely check out David Morgan's Morgan Report. David, thanks for joining me today.
Okay, thanks for having me.
Dave, we got to start off with currencies here. We're seeing the British pound hit 30-year lows, and we know the Bank of England is willing to debase their currency further to combat an economic slowdown in the face of their currency essentially collapsing following Brexit. You know, I got to ask you, what is the significance of this in your mind?
Well, I'll get to that. I'm just going to give some background because there may be listeners that aren't really up to speed, let's say, on exactly what the currency markets have done here with the Brexit. So I'm going to read straight away from the July issue of the Morgan Report, which is about a week old. And I started off saying that the huge news, of course, was the Brexit. The sterling went from the year's high, a little above 150 US, to its lowest level in three decades, approximately 1.32 basis US dollar, in about 7 hours, in an unprecedented move. From a technical point of view, we must assume that stops and optionalities have been wiped out. In other words, a new value will be assigned by the markets. The euro retraced 61.8% of the rally since December 2015 at 109 basis US dollar and spiked through 109.15. However, it recovered nearly back to where it started at 1.12 basis US dollar. The yen, for whatever reason, seemed to be one of the best currencies at the time. However, in light of the recent developments in the G7 statement that's reiterated the undesirability of volatility and disorderly markets, we think the risk of intervention has increased, and that means into the yen or into that foreign currency. The first line of defense will likely be the swap line network developed during the recent financial crisis. After reaching a panic low of 1.4%, the yield on the U.S. 10-year Treasury note rose no higher than 1.6% and finished the week at 1.56, down 5 basis points on the week. So that gives you some flavor for those that may not be attuned to exactly how volatile the currency markets were on the Brexit. Some appreciation. So your question was, you know, what happens or where do we go from here? And I think the answer is more uncertainty and more volatility. Mm-hmm. Certainly not to the high level that I just read you, but it being, you know, I don't really trade currencies much anymore, but I used to trade a lot and almost everything on the board. And you will see moves now, like I just read you, that, and of course this is an exception, but you'll see moves that are average moves for a year. Or let me restate that. You'll see moves that may take a month or two that used to be take a year or two in the currency markets. I mean, this is how things have changed in the last, you know, several decades. And we all get that. There's the more uncertainty there is, the more volatility there is, the more money sloshing around, the more there's the ability to put a big bet, you know, going up or down on almost any commodity or interest rate or, you know, stock commodity, what have you. So interesting times.
David, you know, maybe this is shifting gears, but it's along the same line here. But, you know, Trump claims that countries are unfairly debasing their currencies for exporting advantages, you know, which is helping them with trade. And, you know, he brings up our massive trade deficits with Mexico, China, and, you know, Asian countries. And I guess I would ask you, you know, with what we're seeing with the global problems, would you agree with his articulation that countries are unfairly debasing their currencies?
No, I wouldn't. I would, first of all, point out for everybody that the basic debasement has been on the U.S. dollar. I mean, almost everyone bases their trade on the reserve currency, which is the U.S. dollar. And from 1913 till now, it's been debased about 97%. So if anybody's debased their currency, it's been the United States, and everybody else has been would have to adjust to that fact. The idea that you make your currency cheaper and it helps your exports is somewhat of a misnomer. I mean, you can make the argument that it does, but you can also make the argument it doesn't. Having a strong currency is not a bad thing. But I don't have time to go into that argument. I won't right now. The point being that it's a race to the bottom. Basically, we're in a fiat fiasco, and this fiat fiasco is going to go to its bitter end, which in every case that you haven't had a sound basis for the currency, in other words, when it's the tie to gold or silver or both has been cut, then the route is to destroy the currency. Doesn't necessarily mean a hyperinflation, although a lot of my friends use that. You could certainly get into a situation where you have what most economists say you can't. You can have both. We call it stagflation. You could have where real things that are value keep increasing in price, like food, whereas wages continue to get cut. Those are not good situations, and that's basically what we're witnessing now. I mean, healthcare costs have gone up, college costs have gone up, a lot of things have gone up, much more than the core inflation rate that we're, you know, given by the authority figures. So to answer your question succinctly, no, everybody's doing it. And they're doing it at different rates and at different times, and does it really give them advantage? And that could be debated, yes and no. Again, I won't go into the details, but there's a major contraction going on throughout the entire global empire. It's deteriorating across the board. China's got massive problems on a debt basis. We have massive problems on a debt basis. The Eurozone is actually a basket case with the amount of debt there. They have no way to inflate out because they don't have nation states that are sovereign that can issue their own bonds anymore. They're a united group with lots of different, let's call them personalities. I mean, Spain and France are different personality-wise, yet they're in the same currency system. So this is a mess, and the mess is going to get messier, in my view. So the best thing to do, of course, is take a long, strong, deep breath. Don't get all emotional. Try to look at it objectively and look at what are the real assets that you can own that are not just the precious metals, which is certainly a good starter, a good foundation, a good basis. But, I mean, there are other situations that you can get into. And another thing is ask how can you solve the problem or help solve the problem. There's certainly a need for that. So I think I'll stop there.
You know, it really comes down to these countries, you know, just putting up window dressing and making things look better. Because, sure, if they're debasing their currencies for a higher GDP growth, they're stealing the wealth from their population, their savings, the people's money that they save, they put in the banks, is being compromised for the window dressing numbers for these countries. And I think that's the problem we're seeing across the board. I mean, we saw last month's jobs report come out abysmal. Looking forward to seeing what happens tomorrow here with the jobs report, and, you know, to actually see if that actually gives gold and silver here some further momentum, because we've seen gold and silver really take off here with just some stronger legs, some stronger momentum. And, you know, I guess let's shift into that and get your thoughts here on the bull market we are seeing in gold. And what are your initial thoughts on that?
Well, I pretty much got it right. I mean, I thought that the November-December low 2015 was finally it, and I miscalled that low a couple times, I admit that. I felt very strongly that was it, so I pounded the table. All right, I'm putting my neck out there again, chop it off. This is it. And it was. Mm-hmm. I forecast that January would be extremely strong. It could move into April, perhaps longer, and we have. Right now, we are very overbought on a short-term basis, and the paper paradigm is at an extreme, which means the probability is very strong that we will get a correction. Sooner or later, all markets correct. In other words, nothing goes from, you know, A to B in a straight line in the financial market. So there's ups and downs and ups and downs. What you want to look at is, of course, are you getting higher lows and higher highs? That's an uptrend. Or are you getting lower lows and lower highs? That's a downtrend. Well, right now, we're getting higher highs and higher lows. We're in an uptrend, and that will continue. We may get a big washout and test a certain level. I'm not on my charts right now to pick one, but we, you know, to see silver trade at 18 again would not surprise me. To see it trade at under 14 again would absolutely shock me. I don't think that's in the cards at all. But there are people out there that have a bigger following than me in the mainstream that say, you know, gold's going to test the 1050 bottom. I really, really doubt that.
It really
seems
like
the problem with a lot of people is that they have an amateur's perspective, which means that they think if they didn't get in at the low, they've missed the move. Actually, most of your best traders and wealthiest people on the planet just take out the middle. In other words, they might not even get in a silver market again until it's past 26, and ride it from 26 to 46 and get out and take massive amounts of money out of the market as silver moves up to 100. They know what they're doing. They're not, you know, trading in hindsight. And I'm not suggesting that's the way to play this market. Everyone needs to know themselves and what their best way of doing it is. But to sit there and whine and moan and complain that you didn't get at the bottom, I mean, basically, as many have said, and I'll repeat it, that if silver basically goes from here, from the bottom, wherever that bottom is, to, let's say, 100 U.S. or even 200 U.S. or maybe beyond that, who knows, and you worry about whether you got in at 14 or 18, it's kind of a moot point. But most people don't have the maturity to look at that. They look so short-term, and they're taught to do that rather than actually use the ability that God gave them to think things through. And also, to be grateful. I mean, be grateful for the great money that you made rather than, oh, if I would have got in $4 less, I would have made this much more money. I mean, again, that's sort of a childish amateur attitude. Anyone that's a seasoned investor, and I'm not talking about professionals, I'm talking about someone that's actually been investing in markets for a number of years and has had some losses, some wins, learned things the hard way. Those people are usually pretty mature and are willing to do what they need to do, understand their own philosophy well, and can trade or invest with success. People that look at what might have been, could have been, and should have been are the people that usually are unsuccessful. And that goes across the board through, you know, the philosophy of life, really. If you're always looking at others for what you could have done or should have done, obviously you're not taking responsibility for your own decisions.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I've been telling people that as well, because the emotion of seeing silver at $17 only, what, 7 days ago or whatever, and then looking at it, you know, hit 21 in the $20 range here, you always feel like you missed that opportunity. And in the moment, you don't want to pay that premium. But if you have the foresight to say, you know, this is going to be cheap when silver's at 30, I'm going to wish I had these prices when silver's at 40. That's what you're talking about, that maturity to have a more long-term look on this. So I definitely agree with you on that, David. David, you know, we're seeing the flattening of the yield curve in terms of bonds. I know we talked a little bit about that earlier in terms of what we're seeing with bonds and, you know, in Europe. But historically, when short-term yields spike or invert, we see recessions and stock market crashes. And, you know, in reference to this, is this a reason why we won't see the Fed raise interest rates because they're stuck with the manipulation of the yield curve?
I believe so, yes.
And, you know, is this a potential reason why the stock market could potentially crash or to keep the stock market together? Is it possible that we see the stock market go to new highs, or are we on the verge of a big correction with the market here?
Well, that's a tough one. I mean, I look at my own work, of course, and I try not to get too influenced by others, but the advanced decline line actually doesn't look that bad. Stock market, I would actually have to say, as objectively as I can, looks like it could probably go higher. And I don't think that the stock market correction will come probably till later in the year. I might have to, I may regret those words, but I call them as I see them. You're asking me, in early July, that's the way it looks right now. Basically, I think the seasonalities are probably going to hold, which means that we're going to see a sell-off and a weakening in the precious metals. There's certainly been a lot of sentiment to the positive. In fact, the sentiment is a little too high, and it's overbought, and the paper paradigm is pretty strong on the downside. On the stock market, even a tougher call, and I think that what I've seen and the amount of money that's out there, quote-unquote money currency, stock market could go higher. I mean, we might not see anything even in the September-October time frame, which is a pretty strong seasonality for the stock market to go down. We might not see anything until December. Part of that, and not a lot of it, is based on the presidential lift. I mean, it's pretty well known that, during an election year, that whatever party's in office really wants to do their best to keep the market looking good so that the voters in that party are pleased and they continue to, vote for that party. And that is somewhat true. I mean, I don't want to argue with that, but very tough call in all these markets. I mean, the best thing to do is really to diversify somewhat. Diversify, which means, have assets that are not correlated to each other. Unfortunately, bonds and stocks are heavily correlated to each other. That used to not be the case decades ago, but now it is. It's not true. They are so highly correlated. They do not offset each other. Silver and gold physically are the only really offsets to the stock market and the bond market. So you really need to be invested in those markets, and you don't have to go overboard. I mean, 10% is probably enough for most people. I recommend 20% to the people that are aggressive. And do I have people that have more than that? Yes. And do I? Yes. But that's my specialty, and I'm most comfortable there. Most people wouldn't be that comfortable, especially in the silver market, because the volatility is so high and the moves can be so extreme.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely true. And, when it comes to them keeping things together or in this rigged fashion, I mean, just seeing what happened this week with the FBI kind of pardoning Hillary here, for me, I thought that was going to boost the stock market in itself, because that's going to be, ongoing confirmation that she's a viable candidate and she will be the president. Likely, we'll see what happens here with the whole voting and what happens with Trump. I didn't think Brexit was going to happen, and that did. So I'm optimistic that I could be surprised at what we see going forward, but we will see what happens with that. David, when it comes to the fear trade, even with Brexit or looking at the beginning of the year where we saw the markets go crazy with the news coming out of China, we saw gold move first and then silver follow. There was silver had its move afterwards to a larger degree. It caught up and then some. And I want to ask you, trying to get your thoughts here on silver going forward. We're seeing it hit the $20 range. I mean, that's pretty significant. And, closing in on that gold to silver ratio, what are your thoughts here, gold in comparison to silver and silver specifically?
Well, when you want to trade the ratio, you can do it and try to pick the high, which was like 80-1. That's one way to do it. That's pretty tough. You usually want the markets to tell you what to do rather than you tell the market what to do. So I put in, I think it was a level about 72 or even as low as 70. So when you got a ratio where the gold silver ratio was 70 or less, it was probably a great time to swap gold into silver, because silver will outperform gold. And of course, it vacillates back and forth, which is an opportunity to make more money. So that's point number one. Point number two, silver coming up behind gold. It's a personal, a bit personal, because when I started trading really seriously, I had a very good broker. I had some really poor ones too, but I had a really good broker for a while. And this guy retired at like early 30s from his ability to trade. And he traded a lot of the metals, but he taught me that the whites lead the yellow. And that's not always true. It just isn't, and I know that. But everyone looks at gold as the leader. Certainly it's more of an establishment metal and more coveted by, you know, large entities like banks and, you know, wealth funds and that kind of thing. Silver will play catch up. The problem with silver is, as I wrote, when silver did not move on the Brexit nearly to the level that gold had on that day or two, it was primarily because the physical buying in gold in the UK is not available really in silver, because there's a VAT of about 20%. Yes, there's ways that you can buy silver without the VAT, and I actually wrote an article about it. And several of my members actually wrote me methodologies that you can use to purchase silver in the UK not pay for the VAT legally. So that's part of the setback on silver. Silver is actually, I want to go down the rabbit hole too far, but let me just finish that. If you really study what's going on or has gone on in the silver market, especially during the pound sterling days and the opium wars, you'll see that there's really been more impediments probably to the silver market than the gold market. I mean, the people that like to hear about the manipulations and you know, gold management schemes and all that throughout history, and it's been there almost throughout all of history of the precious metals, you could really get lost looking at what's happened in the silver market. But again, I digress. Point being is that regardless of the VAT or anything else, silver is more affordable, and as these precious metals continue their upward moves, you will continue to see more and more people pour into them, and silver being a pretty kind of a subset of gold, really, you'll see more people move into the silver market, because at some point gold becomes unaffordable to a lot of people, whereas silver remains affordable, at least to some, you know, much greater degree.
Is that going to limit gold's upside potential, just the fact that people will just start buying silver instead as the little brother because it's cheaper?
No, it won't, because there's too much paper out there, and there's too many trillions of dollars or currency that seeks a safe haven. I mean, if you go back to my early days when I started on the speaking circuit, I used to take a little DVD of the rollover movie, and in that movie there is, and it's a fictional docudrama, I'll call it, and one of the lead traders at a New York bank says, you know, there's been a crisis, and that one of these entities is pulling all of their funds out of the banks. And what he says is, foreign currencies, no positions. So that sets the scenes. If you understand what he said that the currency markets are going to be such disarray, you don't want to even be in that market. So he says, foreign currencies, no positions. Bullion, grab what you can get. And then he says, and pray. And then, of course, the trading room breaks out into pandemonium, and yields go off the charts, and the stock markets start falling like crazy, and bullion goes up to 2,000 an ounce, and on it goes. But that's a pretty good analogy for what I think could be in our future. Will it be, you know, a one-day event? Probably not. I mean, it's been deteriorating over years. I mean, really, eight since 2008, nothing's been fixed. They've only added to the problem. They've increased the debt, and the derivatives markets have increased. They've made the problem worse. They poured fuel onto the fire. It's very unfortunate. There was an opportunity in 2008 to probably do something that could correct the problem. One of the first things to have done would have been to implement Glass-Steagall again and make sure that everybody understands, if you're betting with an investment bank, you're high risk and you're gambling, more or less. And if you have a commercial bank, your money's pretty safe, and you have a firewall between them. But during the Billy Clinton days, you know, they took that down under Robert Rubin's tutelage, and now, of course, it's a free-for-all everywhere. And this is unfortunate, because capital is precious, regardless as much as it's been debased. The idea, and especially like the precious metals, because it keeps the system honest for a while anyway, is that people realize that, you know, it's not an easy thing to do. Money doesn't grow on trees, and you just can't print it up. And of course, we can now, but they're more thoughtful, let's say, about investing, whereas now it's just rank speculation across the board, casino that everybody participates in, whether they want to or not. And, you know, it's fun while the party's going. But when the party ends or starts to deteriorate, it starts to get kind of ugly. And this one has been so big for so long and incorporates so many nation states that we're all in this together for the most part. Can the BRICS exit or not? I don't know. I'm not really sure. But when this thing unwinds further, there's going to be some repercussions that will only be dreamed of looking in the past tense, looking from, you know, the future backwards, saying, oh my goodness, if I'd known this, I would have that kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah, you know, major names out there are very concerned. I mean, we even have Alan Greenspan saying things like he doesn't recall a time as bad as this in his history of being involved in the markets. And, you know, what we're seeing here is it going mainstream, the financial collapse going mainstream. And I'm wondering if you would agree with that. Do you see it going mainstream, or is it still an alternative thought to think that the global situation is manageable or sustainable?
Well, I think you're right, Kenneth, that the mainstream has started to use the word, you know, collapse or crisis and put it into print. It definitely is that. And I think that they have to have some modicum of truth. I mean, they are such propagandists that, you know, getting a real truth out of the mainstream is a real effort or almost impossible to do. But they can't obfuscate it so much that it's a blatant lie. I mean, like 1984, you know, freedom is slavery, war is peace, and ignorance is something, I forget. But this is not the situation here. They have to actually put in something that, you know, makes some sense to most people, because it's so blatantly obvious. And so I think that you'll see more and more of it. You know, the alternative media is far superior for gathering actual facts. But again, you know, it's a free market on the internet. So buyer beware. I mean, there's stuff out there that's very, very valuable and viable. And there's stuff out there that's complete propaganda, just like the mainstream press is. So you got to be a little bit careful. I like to read across the board. I like to read outside of the U.S. I like to read both sides, you know, the left and the right, and form an opinion. And there's things out there that I don't have an opinion on at all, because I don't have the time to study it long enough to really form one. So, you know, people trust me for the most part, and I'm happy about that. I feel honored that they do. But just because I'm trustworthy doesn't mean that I have, you know, good opinions on everything. There's some stuff, again, that, you know, I just don't have the time, you know. And I say that, I mean, you don't have to have an opinion on everything. I mean, a lot of people have an opinion that they've picked up from someone else and they make it theirs without any real in-depth research whatsoever, you know. Well, the New York Times says blah 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 blah, well, therefore I have the blah 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 blah. Well, you know what, why don't you read at least one alternate to that, mm-hmm. and see, you know, what you come up with. But anyway, I digress.
Yeah, take some time to wrap your mind around the opinion before you just base it on something that you heard. Yeah, good insight right there. David, when it comes to junior mining, the sector, the commodities, the investment opportunity, we have not seen a year like 2016 in quite some time. It's been spectacular, actually, the amount of money that's been flowing into the sector this year, and the gains that people are seeing have been pretty substantial, you know. And I want to get your thoughts on this. I know this is a big focus of what you do, what you spend your time on. So any insight that you'd like to share regarding this?
Okay, well, I'll take a little bit off of that, Kenneth. We specialize in helping people make big money in this market, and we do that by not spending too much effort into the junior mining space. We do look at that space and probably take more time there than we do for, like, the large investments would be in the top tier space and the mid tier space. The juniors are very, very difficult. But they can certainly run, as we all know. And I have a track record of actually having more picks in the junior mining space that became mines than anybody else in the industry. And I'm not a geologist. And the reason I could probably do that is because I understand it's a people business. And if you get the right people, they're going to make something happen eventually. Having said all that, yes, there's ways to make money, and that's what we specialize at the Morgan Report, is to make money balancing risk with reward. I had a consultation client just yesterday, and he has quite a bit in the markets, primarily into the resource sector, primarily follows all of my work, has some assets outside of the Morgan Report recommendations, and I never said we get them all or to get them all right. And you don't have to get every single stock out there to make a good profit. But he was primarily interested in increasing his juniors more than I have on our list. So during the consultation, what we talked about was his ability, and he wanted to continue to roll over options on the long side. So I explained that option writers make money, option buyers lose money. 80% of the time, the writer makes money. So I suggested for him to do some more study into option writing, taking that money that he was getting from renting a stock and take that money and put it into the junior sector. So he's letting his own solid net base work for him to be able to speculate further into an industry that he's very interested in. So that's just an idea for, you know, the listeners. It's rather sophisticated. Some people are going, what the hell is David talking about? And if you're saying that, that's fine. I'm not here to suit, you know, I'm not here running for office. You know, I'm not trying to please everybody. I mean, I've been a maverick and a one percenter for a long time. It's not an elitist. It's a fact that very few people have ever woken up to the way money works. And the last thing I want to say is that, you know, if we don't change the way money works, nothing's going to change in the future. In other words, you know, with this paradigm that a few can issue it and get usury off of it and basically hold down the power structure because they have the ability to print money for their own benefit, and basically push everybody else down, or at least control them, control the political scene, control the environmental scene, control all kinds of things through the power of money, we're in a very, very sick place. We've got to change the way money works, or we're not going to change anything.
Wow. Well, David, those were some great closing thoughts right there, and I want to thank you for coming on the show with me today and giving us an update, very timely, especially with what we're seeing in the markets and precious metals at the moment. So thanks so much for coming on the show. And if people want to reach out to you, let them know the website and you know, what your latest offering is.
Sure. We've rebranded to themorganreport.com. It's because we do things across the board, and not just in the resource sector, but we do a lot more than silver. And so it's resources focused primarily. And we look at the currencies, we look at bonds, we look at a lot of things. And you can get a free report. So just get it over there, get your first name and your primary email address, get on our free email list, and we'll keep you informed of what's going on. And the first report you get, Riches and Resources, is a pretty good read and has a pretty good couple of documentaries to really bring you up to speed if you're not clear on where we are on a global basis. And it's also something, if you are clear, that you could forward to friends and family to have them take a look at a couple of these movies that I put in that report that gives you an idea of the age of empire and the collapse of empire, and also what happened during the Argentina crisis, because most often I get the questions, well, what will it look like? Well, I'll show you what it looked like in Argentina. Does that mean that's how it's going to look in Texas? No. But it gives you a pretty good idea of what it could look like in other nation states because of it actually happening in 2000, year 2000 in Argentina.
Good words right there, David. Thanks so much for coming on the show.
My pleasure. Thank you.